Goodbye, full stack. SpaceX destacks Ship 30. Why would they do that? Launch Mount B sees massive work. The Star Factory is expanding. Say goodbye to the office building. Falcon 9 has its third mishap in just 3 months. What does the FAA think? And SpaceX prepares to launch the most ambitious mission of the year. And I am not talking about Starship. My name is Felix. Welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Another week at Starbase and another colossal development. Let's start with the most obvious. Where did the full stack go? Yep, it looks like SpaceX didn't want to keep the rocket fully stacked for a month and a half, so on the 30th, SpaceX moved the chopsticks into position right below Ship 30's flaps and lifted it into the air once again. It was then lowered back to the ground. Shortly after that, the hot staging ring was hooked up to the LR11000 crane before being removed from the booster. Then that night, the booster transport stand was rolled back to the production site. Wait, isn't it missing something? It seems that despite SpaceX removing everything on top of the booster, booster 12 itself will remain on the launch mount for now. It's possible SpaceX just didn't want to roll both back at the same time or wanted to provide some stress relief for the booster itself. However, given that they also removed the hot staging ring, it's also possible SpaceX realized that more work needed to be done on the booster before Flight 5. We could also see SpaceX perform more testing on it. As they still have at least a month and a half until Flight 5, it would likely be a good idea to get as much data as possible. After all of this data can also be used to improve the other launch pads SpaceX is building for the Starship program. With them ramping up production with the goal of being able to launch multiple times a day, one launch pad isn't going to be enough for this program for much longer. That is why they are focusing so much time and energy on their new launch pad B. Thanks to our recent flyover, we can see that SpaceX has begun excavating the ground below it. Unlike the previous pad, this one will be equipped with a flame diverter to prevent excessive damage to the pad or vehicle during the early stages of a launch. That's why they need to dig down in this area, as building a flame diverter up would likely require even more resources, as well as take up valuable land, which is in limited supply at this launch complex. So far, only minor work has been done on the main trench of the flame diverter. Instead, most of the recent work has been focused along this outer area between the two sheet pile walls that SpaceX had installed over the past month. Here you can see that SpaceX has already dug out large portions. It will be used as a commodities trench to run the necessary piping to transport propellant to the booster and ship. Work on this area will likely go somewhat slowly, as SpaceX also needs to fight any trapped groundwater. This process can be quite difficult given that the water table is only a few feet below the ground. However, elsewhere, work on the ground support hardware for this pad has been moving rapidly. Over the past few weeks, SpaceX has been working on excavating large trenches between the new launch pad and the propellant tank farm to connect it to pad B. And now, after adding those pipes, they've covered the trench back up. The tank farm isn't quite connected yet, this is just the first area, but it shouldn't be much longer before it is. All of this pipe work will also likely connect to the air separation plant. As soon as SpaceX produces nitrogen and oxygen on site, it can add it straight to the tank farm. With all the work SpaceX is doing on the flame diverter and the ground support equipment, there is one piece we still haven't talked about. That is, of course, the tower. Before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a WISE supporter. Why? Because with it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far. Satellite, aerial, and ground photos, more than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week. Insights, chats with me, you name it. Thank you so much, you rock. Every day, Tower B looks closer and closer to completion. It is now at its full height and has much of the internals connected. However, it is still missing quite a few components. One of these important but least obvious things that still need to be added is concrete. When these modules were built and stacked, the main structural beams were just hollow pieces of metal to reduce weight. But since the tower has been stacked, SpaceX has begun filling these with concrete to increase its strength. SpaceX began doing this just shortly after the tower was stacked, and although it's hard to tell how high up on the tower they've managed to fill, it's likely that a few modules are still missing concrete. This can be one of the most time-consuming processes, as the concrete needs to be added in layers to ensure it has time to cure. Of course, the most obvious things still missing from the tower are the catch arms and the ship quick disconnect. To see those pieces, we need to head to the Sanchez site, as that is where they are being stored and worked on. Thanks to our recent flyover, we can see that both of these pieces of equipment have received quite a lot of work. Starting with the chopsticks, we can see that the upgrades SpaceX had been preparing to add to them are now well underway. The weld lines and stress points are being prepped, and some sections have already received the reinforcements. These are almost identical to the ones that were added to the arms on Tower A, and adding them here on the ground should be much easier and quicker than adding them after these are stacked. We can also see that just like on Tower A, SpaceX removed the bumpers for these chopsticks, meaning that the reasoning was just to reinforce them, and SpaceX only performed tests without them because the bumpers were unnecessary for those tests. So those should be added back any day now. These reinforcements are likely also the reason these arms are still on the ground instead of on the tower. But looking just above the arms, we can see the final missing piece, the ship quick disconnect. After months of wondering and speculation about where this piece of the tower is, it's finally decided to show up. First, we just saw one or two pieces being rolled in, but now we have almost the full thing, and SpaceX was mid-assembly during our flyover. Hey guys! Looking at the pieces that SpaceX has brought in, we can see that they look almost identical to the SQD on the first tower. So it's just going to be the same design with no upgrades? Not necessarily. So far, SpaceX has brought over most of the pieces, but not all of them. The SQD actually consists of two main structures. The first is what we see here. It is close to the tower, which acts as the main structure for the SQD. The other piece is closer to the ship, and if there are going to be any changes, the majority would likely be there, as it is much closer to the flames on launch and typically needs the most repairs.
It moves like this.
It would be a bit odd, in my opinion, if SpaceX decided to keep the same design between Tower A and Tower B's ship quick disconnect, given the trouble that Tower A's has caused for SpaceX after every launch, but we'll have to wait and see. And thanks to some new info, we may not need to wait much longer to find out. Now here comes a big one. Listen to this. During the launch of Crew 9 to the International Space Station, SpaceX's commentators revealed that the new launch pad for Starships should be completed by early 2025. So let the countdown begin. Given that SpaceX needs to perform a lot of work on the launch mount and tower after the main components are installed, the main structure will likely be completed before the end of the year. Some parts need to hurry up, like the launch mount, which has finally started having its parts delivered. Just a few days ago, it received even more, with what appear to be corner pieces for the new OLM, or orbital launch mount, being brought to the Sanchez site and lifted on what is assumed to be the assembly stand. If that is the case, we should start seeing this new launch mount take shape over the next few days, and we will finally get an idea for what it may look like. As of now, it's still up in the air whether or not this will be a movable launch mount, similar to the static fire stand which SpaceX built for Massey's, or fixed, like the orbital launch mount for Pad A. It may be a challenge to avoid a movable launch mount for a vehicle the size of Starship, even if it has been done before, such as with the Saturn V or SLS. But the benefits are numerous, such as ease of repair and possibly even the ability to move it out of the way for a booster and ship landing to avoid damage. Maybe the most important advantage would be having a spare launch mount. Rapid launch cadence, anyone? Do you think SpaceX will take the knowledge they learned from building the stand at Massey's and bring it over to the new orbital launch mount? Or do you think they will stick with a fixed pad? Let me know what you think below. Let's move our attention to the other side of the production yard, where we have the office building. Thanks to our recent flyover, we were able to get a good look at the progress of the building and the walkway connecting it to the Star Factory. Or at least what we thought would be a walkway, because it looks like it's turning from a walkway into a full-on extension of the Star Factory. Thanks to previous flyovers, we were able to spot that SpaceX was installing foundation piles around this area. This means SpaceX isn't just going to stop with this one section, they may end up expanding across the whole length of the office building. If the Star Factory keeps growing like this, it might just completely engulf the office. This is likely closer to SpaceX's original plan. However, after they had trouble acquiring this small piece of land, the plans needed to be changed. But now they've acquired the land, and it seems they still want to expand that way. Given that the expansion might possibly completely connect the two buildings, we may not have an office building for much longer, but rather a Star Factory with a significantly large office space. I wish my office was part of a rocket factory. I mentioned Crew 9's launch earlier, and despite successfully carrying the two crew members to space aboard Crew Dragon, it wasn't quite as successful as it could have been. Unfortunately for SpaceX, it appears that after the Falcon 9's upper stage completed its mission of successfully carrying people to space, it encountered an anomaly. Typically, when a rocket's second stage completes its mission, it still has one more task ahead. It needs to find a safe location for it to go. At least for Western launch providers, that is a must by law. After all, once something is in orbit, it's going to stay in orbit for a while, or when high enough, even forever. It's better if you're the one controlling where it goes down instead of a random chance. Because of that, it is important that anybody who cares about keeping space travel safe for anyone on the ground or in orbit either bring the second stage back into the atmosphere or place it in a graveyard orbit. In this case, the Falcon 9 upper stage was to perform a short deorbit burn to bring it back into the Earth's atmosphere, where it safely burns up and lands in a pre-designed and unpopulated portion of the Pacific Ocean. However, it seems that in this case, the upper stage performed off-nominal. Wait, so should I be watching out for falling rockets? Fortunately, no. In this case, all off-nominal means is it just underperformed slightly and already re-entered. And thanks to some calculations by Jonathan McDowell, we know that its impact location was still in a completely uninhabited region of the Pacific Ocean. No danger, Will Robinson. Sure enough, the FAA announced shortly after in a statement that no public injuries or property damage had been recorded due to the off-nominal burn and that it just re-entered a bit outside the designated area. Unfortunately for SpaceX, this anomaly does require the FAA to perform an investigation, meaning the Falcon 9 will be grounded for a bit. This will be Falcon 9's third grounding in the last 3 months. The previous two groundings were caused by a failed landing by a booster back in August and, interestingly, an off-nominal burn of a second stage that actually led to a mission failure back in July. I wonder if these two incidents are related in some way. Unfortunately, because SpaceX doesn't show the re-entry burn, there is no way to tell what exactly went wrong. In fact, even if the engine had performed a rapid unscheduled disassembly, we wouldn't know until we get an official statement. So Falcon 9 is grounded. Surely the FAA will drag its feet on this as well, right? Probably not. Despite many recent grievances that SpaceX and many others have had with the FAA, specifically in the case of Starship, when it comes to Falcon 9, the FAA is a well-oiled machine at this point. Remember, I said that SpaceX had already had two groundings before this one in the last 3 months, and yet they have still managed to launch 23 times over the course of those 3 months. I know there has been a lot of negativity pointed at the FAA, but it's important to remember that they are doing their best with their resources and regulations. So it is important to give credit where credit is due. The FAA's handling of the Falcon rocket family is commendable. Because of their speed and flexibility with this program, the grounding will likely only last a few days. In fact, by the time you watch this, another Falcon 9 may have already launched. Hopefully, this grounding will not affect any upcoming missions, because SpaceX is set to launch arguably the most groundbreaking Falcon Heavy mission to date. So what mission is that? Well, I'm talking about Europa Clipper. This could be one of the most important missions of 2024. This space probe, developed by NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, is set to fly to Jupiter's moon Europa to study it and what is believed to be its subsurface ocean. You know, just another spot inside our solar system where there could be life. Even if there is no life there, this place is full of wonders. And the engineering that went into this project is nothing short of extraordinary. Let's take a look, starting with the reason for this mission, its scientific array. The ocean Europa Clipper is attempting to study is beneath an estimated 10 to 15 mile thick and solid ice crust. To accomplish this task, the probe is fitted with a vast array of 9 highly advanced instruments, some of which are designed to penetrate the ice. This includes instruments like Reason, which is a gigantic radar scanner placed across the whole vessel, designed to send radio waves through the ice that will bounce off anything below the surface, such as water, to provide a picture of what Europa looks like beneath its icy crust.
Ooh, I like it.
Other instruments, such as mass specs, are designed to collect gases from the extremely thin atmosphere of Europa to analyze them. But Europa Clipper has a bit of a problem. The place where it's going isn't exactly friendly. Jupiter is the largest planet in our solar system, and it also has the largest magnetic field. Now, from what you may know on Earth, having a magnetic field can be good. It protects us from solar radiation and makes life possible here on our little blue dot. But when traveling in space around Earth or any planet with a strong magnetic field, the radiation that we are protected from here on the surface can become trapped in layers of the magnetic field out in space. These regions are called the Van Allen belts. Ever heard of Apollo astronauts having to cross these belts on their journey to the moon and get roasted? On Jupiter, this is taken to the extreme, with many of this gas giant's moon bathed in enough radiation to make Chernobyl look like a spa. Unfortunately for Europa Clipper, radiation is often just as bad for electronics as it is for people. These high-energy particles can completely destroy the delicate code used to run the probes. Because of that, JPL built this probe to be extremely radiation-resistant. Though even with all the work the engineers did, Europa Clipper can only survive for a limited time in this high-radiation environment. That's why it will only be spending brief periods in the belts. The reason this mission is called Europa Clipper is because this probe will not be orbiting this moon, but rather orbiting Jupiter at a safe distance and quickly flying by or clipping Europa. It's hoped that by doing this, scientists will be able to gather as much data over as long a period of time as possible, allowing them to observe changes to the surface that could be caused by the subsurface ocean. That is spectacular stuff. Another interesting fact about this mission is that it's all powered by solar panels, which is extremely difficult given Jupiter's distance from the sun. These solar panels need to be gigantic, at over 100 feet or about the size of a 10-story building. All of this contributes to the craft's massive weight of over 13,000 pounds at launch, making Europa Clipper the largest interplanetary mission NASA has ever attempted. It truly pushes Falcon Heavy's capabilities to their limits, requiring all 3 boosters to be expended, including the side boosters that were previously used for another very ambitious mission by NASA, Psyche. And even with all of its boosters being expended, this mission will still take around 6 years to reach Jupiter. Of course, all of this ambition didn't come cheap, with the price tag of Europa Clipper weighing in at about $5 billion, or half a James Webb Space Telescope. All of this is worth it, as this mission has the possibility of opening up a whole new world, or in this case, a moon to us. Here on Earth, we know that where there is water, there is life, and with this mission about to spend years studying liquid water on Europa, we can only wonder what secrets Europa Clipper will reveal. So be sure to mark your calendars and keep an eye out for October 10th, the earliest launch window, as well as other possible launch windows for the next few weeks until this incredible mission gets its chance to fly. Good luck, Europa Clipper, you rock. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more. This is what fuels the algorithm. This is how you can help us for free. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A new Raptor design and our epic Flight 5 design are both up. We're running another campaign, giving you completely free standard shipping on everything in the US store from October 3rd to the 8th. Link is in the description and in the card you should see now. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode.
Goodbye, full stack.
Goodbye.
I'm sorry, I'm goofy today.
To prevent, to divert the danger.
The hoy
itself offered me designated, damn it.
Excuse me.